All right, good evening. Welcome to the program. You're listening to The Soapbox here on 90.9 104.1 WMPG, Southern Maine's community radio from the University of Southern Maine. My name is Eric Poulin. Thank you very much for joining me this evening. If you like what you hear and you want to listen to some previous episodes, then you can find The Soapbox on YouTube. We have all of the previous episodes there. We have our own channel, excuse me, and you can also find The Soapbox on Facebook at facebook.com/TheSoapboxPortland. So please like us there and contribute to the discussion. You're also welcome to join the conversation this evening. We have a live interview tonight, and so call in at 780-4909 if you would like to join the conversation. Tonight we will be talking with Josh Ruebner, the author of Shattered Hopes, Obama's Failure to Broker Israeli-Palestinian Peace, and also the policy director of the U.S. Campaign to End Israeli Occupation. Welcome to the program, Josh.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks for being here. So obviously tonight, listeners, we will be talking about the violence that is occurring in Palestine at the moment, and this is sort of a hot topic right now, a sensitive topic right now. Lots of famous and celebrity individuals have been caught, you know, making very sort of vague comments and have been held to account by an angry citizenry and or more likely an angry mass media. Josh, have you observed this? What is this about? People can't seem to talk sensibly about the Israel-Palestine issue in the media.
Yeah, it's very dangerous for celebrities to speak out. Dwight Howard, the basketball player, Rihanna, the singer, both tweeted out Free Palestine and were forced against their will to delete those tweets. But that being said, there are more and more celebrities who are speaking out against Israel's oppression. Just the other day, the groups, the Institute for Middle East Understanding and Jewish Voice for Peace, released a video with different celebrities like Gloria Steinem, like Chuck D, speaking out against these atrocities that Israel is committing against Palestinians in the Gaza Strip. So it's not impossible for celebrities to speak out, and more are doing so, but clearly there's pressure on them not to.
Okay, where is that pressure coming from? Why is that pressure being exerted?
Well, in general, any time the media or celebrities try to paint a sympathetic picture toward the Palestinian people, there's pressure brought to bear from the pro-Israel lobby in this country not to communicate those feelings and those images. We saw that very clearly early on in this barbaric attack on Palestinians in Gaza, when NBC's correspondent, a fellow by the name of Ayman Muhyiddin, reported from Gaza. He was actually playing soccer with those four Becker cousins who were killed on the beach by an Israeli naval shell moments before they were killed, and he filed incredibly moving pieces about the killing of these little children on the beach in Gaza City. And immediately he was reassigned by NBC, forced to leave his posting in Gaza. Fortunately, on this occasion, we helped to mobilize counter pressure on NBC to actually bring this reporter back and to keep providing Americans through the mainstream media with a brief glimpse into the realities of what's taking place in Gaza.
So, I don't want to get stuck on this point, but I'm and obviously it's very sensitive. I think because there are groups of people in America who might like jump to some conclusions, but like, is there an Israeli lobby or so? Are there moneyed interests that in the mass media that have a stake in kind of keeping the narrative shaped in a certain way?
Oh, absolutely. And to talk about the existence of an Israel lobby in this country is not at all conspiratorial. I mean, there are probably, I would say, hundreds of groups that are part of this Israel lobby and that lobby quite openly for the United States to maintain lock, stock, and barrel, unconditional political and military support for Israel, to try to paint Israel as friendly as possible in the American media. All these groups operate openly and are quite open about this being their mission statement.
Okay, so maybe Josh, you can kind of like give us, I know this is an incredibly complicated issue, but give us sort of a thumbnail sketch to get us up to speed. So after World War II, right? Jews were looking for a homeland, and they did they confiscate land in Palestine, or what happened that brought the Jews to Israel?
Well, what happened briefly, obviously, that's
right.
A long history of more than 100 years, but in the late 1800s, the Zionist movement began to colonize the land of Palestine, to turn it into a Jewish homeland, and it got official British backing to do so in the aftermath of World War I, when the Ottoman Empire collapsed and Britain held the mandate for Palestine, which it did up until 1947. Now, at the time when Britain turned Palestine over to the UN to figure out, Jews owned 7% of the land of historic Palestine. Palestinians resided on the other 93% of the land, and the demographic balance between the population was about two-thirds indigenous, Palestinian, Muslim, and Christian, and one-third Jewish. Now, the UN, against the wishes of the majority of the inhabitants of Palestine, decided to partition this land into two countries, a Jewish state on 55% of the land and an Arab state on 45%. What Israel did when it was established in May 1948 was to engage in a very premeditated, very deliberate campaign of ethnic cleansing to drive out as many Palestinians from what became Israel as possible. So today there are 1.8 million people, Palestinians, in the Gaza Strip. 80% of the population who live in Gaza are refugees from this act of ethnic cleansing of Palestinians from what became Israel in 1948. And here we are 66 years later. Israel has denied these refugees their internationally guaranteed right of return to go back to their homes, which are in some cases just a few miles away from where they're currently blockaded in the Gaza Strip. Now, Egypt held control of the Gaza Strip until 1967, when Israel conquered it and the West Bank and took control of 100% of historic Palestine in that war, which is the situation that obtains today. Israel maintains 100% control over all of the lands of historic Palestine, and Palestinians are denied their human and national rights. They're denied their right to self-determination. And in the case of the Gaza Strip, they've been living under this illegal blockade for the past 9 years, which is a form of collective punishment against the entire civilian population, where they're not allowed adequate access to food, to clean water, to medical supplies. You name it, it's denied by Israel.
Okay, at this point, I would like to throw out a couple points of note for listeners. One, and this is not in direct response to anything that was just said, but I think we may have forgotten to do this before we started the show. This is, as we mentioned, a sensitive topic, and the opinions of the speakers are those of the speakers alone and not necessarily representative of WMPG as a station. And also, please don't hesitate to join the conversation. Call us at 780-4909. So, Josh, the narrative that I seem to see in the media is that Hamas is a terrorist organization. They are launching rockets indiscriminately into Israel and threatening their civilian population. And doesn't Israel have a right to protect themselves? And isn't that what they are doing? What is wrong with this narrative? How is the mainstream media missing on its coverage?
Right. Well, first, terrorism is a very, very loaded term, especially in the aftermath of the September 11th attacks that we faced in this country. So first of all, we need to define what terrorism is before throwing that term out there to describe a certain organization. Terrorism is the use of violence, deliberately targeting civilians to achieve political objectives. Nothing more, nothing less. So when a Palestinian militant group fires rockets indiscriminately at Israeli population centers, it's violating human rights, it's violating international law, and yes, it's committing an act of terrorism. But terrorism is not a strategy that is limited to non-state actors. It's also equally applicable to the actions of state actors as well. So what we need to ask ourselves, if we're going to throw labels around calling Hamas a terror group, we also have to ask ourselves whether Israel's actions qualify it as engaging in terrorism as well. And in fact, this is the official doctrine of the Israeli military. It's called the Dahiya Doctrine, which is named for some of the suburbs of Beirut, Lebanon, where this deadly practice was first put into place in 2006. And the Dahiya Doctrine calls for Israel to engage in deliberately targeted disproportionate violence against civilians to obtain political objectives. This is what the definition of terrorism is. So when we see the Israeli military massacring hundreds of innocent Palestinian civilians, including more than 250 Palestinian children, deliberately targeting them and their homes and their schools and their hospitals and their UN shelters, this too is terrorism. So let's not absolve Israel of the charge of committing acts of terrorism because it is terrorizing the Palestinian population. Now, as to the right of self-defense, it's absolutely true. Every country has the right to protect their citizens. So if this is something that applies to Israel, Palestinians also have the right of self-defense. How can you say that only Israel should be allowed to have weapons, that only Israel should be allowed to engage in violence, that Palestinians don't have the right to pick up weapons and fight Israeli soldiers who are invading their homes and their neighborhoods? This doesn't make any sense. And besides, Israel is protected and its citizens are protected very well from Palestinian rocket fire because since 2010, the United States has provided Israel with more than $700 million for what's known as the Iron Dome anti-missile defense system. This is a very effective system, which, according to the Israeli military, knocks down 90% of incoming missiles. So Israeli civilians are protected from Palestinian rocket fire. What Israel is doing in terms of these indiscriminate and deliberate attacks against Palestinian civilians and civilian infrastructure has absolutely nothing to do with self-defense. This is a war of aggression. There are war crimes being committed, potential crimes against humanity. And the worst part of it is that we are backing it with our weapons, with our diplomatic protection, which is why the United States is complicit against these crimes that are taking place against the Palestinians.
I want to jump back briefly to the Dahiya Doctrine that you mentioned. That was something that I kind of came across in my preparation for the show, and it really jumped out at me. And I'm wondering if you can kind of explain it a little bit further. Is this something that has explicitly been adopted by the Israeli government? Is this something that sort of like, you know, people assume that they're adhering to? Or what is the relationship between the actions of the Israeli government and the actual Dahiya Doctrine, which again, you say allows for the disproportionate use of force to inflict suffering on the civilian population in order to achieve political goals.
Yeah, that's exactly right. The Dahiya Doctrine is the strategic doctrine of the Israeli military in terms of dealing with the Lebanese civilian population in its wars against Hezbollah, or against the Palestinian civilian population in its wars against Hamas. This is the operative strategic doctrine of the army and of the military.
So I think you can plainly see it in effect when you look at the death toll as of July 28th, was 1,088, more than 4,000 injured, most of them civilians. Independent sources indicate that only 15% of the killed have been combatants. Where is the outrage? I think that on the ground level, I think a lot of people are outraged, and then there are a lot of people who don't know. What is holding us back from holding the Israeli government accountable, do you think?
Well, there is a lot of outrage in this country. There have been protests, many, many protests in every single major U.S. city. Some of them have turned out thousands and thousands of Americans from all races, all religions, all ethnicities, opposing U.S. support for Israel's war crime against the Palestinian people. So that opposition is there. The problem is that the grassroots mobilization that we've seen in support of justice for the Palestinian people has not yet built up the political strength to fundamentally change our country's policies and our media, and even to a larger extent, our decision makers have proven themselves to be virtually completely immune so far from this pressure. So clearly, it's at the institutional elite level where we need to make some headway in terms of being able to change and end these U.S. policies which support Israel's atrocious, barbaric attacks against the Palestinian people.
All right, 780-4909, if you're listening and you would like to join in the conversation. You're listening to The Soapbox on WMPG, and my guest this evening is Josh Ruebner, the author of Shattered Hopes, Obama's Failure to Broker Israeli-Palestinian Peace, and also the policy director of the U.S. Campaign to End Israeli Occupation. Okay, Josh, I'd like to ask you a question that, let me see if I can phrase this. It's sort of a difficult question, but so I think pretty clearly Israel is deeply insecure about the possibility of Palestinian statehood, like a viable Palestinian state, one that is not under their thumb, right? And I think the reason that they're insecure is because clearly there are violent impulses directed towards them from within Palestine, that if they had their own state, they had their own military, very well may become a larger scale conflict. Of course, those impulses have been born out of, it seems, the oppression that Israelis have arguably exerted on the Palestinians. So I guess my question is this just a hopelessly intractable situation? How do we come out of this in a way that is peaceful and that respects human rights on both sides and allows for the freedom of individuals on both sides of this conflict?
Yeah, absolutely. That should be the goal. And I think anytime you have a situation of oppression where there is a governmental system put in place to inflict collective injustices against a particular people, the oppressor is always going to be afraid of what the oppressed is thinking and doing and might do after the oppression ends. This is always the psychological dynamic at play when you have oppression. You saw it in South Africa. You saw it in this country in terms of ending slavery. Many slave owners understood that the institution of slavery was not tenable in the long run, but they were scared to lift the boot off of the neck of the enslaved population because they feared getting retribution for all of their injustices. Mm-hmm. And I think this dynamic underlies the continuation of this injustice between Israel and the Palestinian people today as well. So how do you dig yourself out of this hole? How do you get yourself out of this box that Israel has trapped itself in? Mm-hmm. And this fear that it's created for itself of living as equals with the people whose land they've colonized. Well, the only way to get out of this trap is to stop the oppression. You cannot ask the oppressed to negotiate a so-called peace with you while you're continuing to keep your boots on the neck of the oppressed. It doesn't work that way. The ANC, the African National Congress, didn't come to the table with the Afrikaner apartheid government before that government committed to abolish the system of apartheid in South Africa. And the same thing needs to be true to resolve this conflict equitably. Israel has to abolish its system of separate and unequal apartheid treatment toward the Palestinian people to enable that type of future, which we all hope for.
Is there an international justice system or an international court that the leaders of Palestine could turn to and point to, as you say, what are potentially war crimes happening, terrorist acts, conducted by a state, but terrorist acts potentially nonetheless. Is there somewhere that they could turn sort of an independent international arbiter of this conflict that's going on?
Yeah, absolutely. They can join the International Criminal Court. And if they do so, they will be allowed to bring war crimes charges against Israeli political and military figures for their actions. So the question is, why hasn't the state of Palestine, as is recognized by the UN as a non-member state, why haven't they done this? And the reason why, up to this point, is because the United States and Israel have leveraged tremendous pressure against the Palestinians from going to the ICC, because the dominant narrative of the United States is that any actions that Palestinians take outside of the framework of this so-called peace process, which is completely dead to begin with, are illegitimate. And so the United States is working hand in hand with Israel to cut off Palestine from going to the ICC and to bring these kind of cases forward. Now, this might change in the wake of this most recent massacre that we're seeing unfolding today. We'll have to wait and see.
Okay, we've got a caller on the line. Ty from York, you are on with Josh Ruebner. Please go ahead.
You asked the one part of my question is that the Palestinians are definitely living in a state of apartheid. And within that system, what does the Israelis feel in, the people, the population feel in about, like, what is going on? I mean, everybody's talking, but what does the Israelis feel, the citizens feel about the way the Palestinians are being treated? Because when I listen to the news in Democracy Now!, it always seems like they're having these programs where Israeli or Palestinians are meeting each other for the first time in 10 years, and it's like this like incredible thing. There's no seem to be any kind of integration within, like, you know, I know in the apartheid system, the government does not want the population to integrate with the people that they're trying to oppress. But, I mean, what is the Israeli stand in all of this, the average citizen?
That's my question. Thank you, Ty. That's a really great question. Josh, what do you think?
Right. There were some public opinion polls that just came out yesterday saying that Israeli Jews supported their government's current massacres of the Palestinians in Gaza Strip at a 95% rate. It's almost unanimous Israeli Jewish opinion in favor of what Israel is doing against the Palestinians in Gaza. Now, I say Israeli Jews because 20% of Israeli citizens are Palestinian. They were the Palestinians who were not ethnically cleansed from their homes in 1948 in what became Israel. But they're very much considered second-class citizens at best. There are dozens of Israeli laws which discriminate against them in terms of housing and education and social benefits and so forth. And it very much is an apartheid system. And right now, really wall-to-wall unanimity amongst Israeli Jews backing this. That being said, I mean, there are, of course, individual Israeli Jews and Israeli Jewish organizations that are doing outstanding work to protest their government's policies. But unfortunately, they're a very, very small minority.
I got to say, Josh, anytime I hear a poll that says 95% of any group of people agree on something, I'm deeply suspicious. I mean, has this been independently verified, this poll? Is this an official poll, you know, from the Israeli government? Where does this come from?
You know, it's in various press reports. I don't have it at my fingertips, and there are actually several that came out showing, you know, different questions, but between 80 and 95%. I was shocked, too, at the unanimity, because there's never been that degree of unanimity in Israeli society towards what the government does to the Palestinians. And I think it shows that Israeli Jewish society is really, really rallying around the flag to a much greater extent than before.
Okay, Joe in Portland, you're on the air. We've got very little time left, so please make your comments brief.
Sure, and my comments are brief. I think that earlier the host characterized the situation over there as possibly intractable, and I think a lot of people would agree with that. My argument is that the region is two great leaders at the same time away from a solution, and until that happens, no solution will happen. And then I have the question, which is, why does your guest think that it's Barack Obama or any U.S. president's responsibility to take care of this problem?
Okay.
That's it. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Joe.
Yeah, that's a great question. And before I answer that, let me just put in a quick plug for one of our member groups of our coalition, the Maine Voices for Palestinian Rights. If you're upset about U.S. support for Israel's massacres against the people of the Gaza Strip, there'll be a protest in Portland, Congress Square, the corner of High and Congress Streets, Friday afternoon, 5 o'clock. And you can get more information at mvprights.org. Look, the reason why the United States is responsible is because we are so complicit. It's our military aid, it's our diplomatic support that perpetuates Israel's injustice and system of oppression toward the Palestinian people. Now, I don't believe that the United States can be an honest broker, but I do believe that we should end our complicity by making sure that we are ending U.S. military aid to Israel, removing our veto in the U.N., which is preventing Israel from being held accountable in those forums.
Okay, Josh. Josh Ruebner, my guest this evening, I want to thank you very much for being here tonight. There's so much to talk about, and we might just have to have you back sometime so that we can continue this conversation. I feel like we're just beginning to scratch the surface.
I'd be glad to. Thanks for having me on.
Okay. And thank you to Ty and Joe for calling in. You are listening to The Soapbox here on 90.9 104.1 WMPG. You can find us online at facebook.com/thesoapboxportland, and you can join the conversation there and find links to previous episodes. Once again, my thanks to Josh Ruebner. Thank you to Michael and Lisa for engineering this evening. Much gratitude to them. And stick around for Night on Earth with Byron coming up next here on WMPG. The last soul. Now little David was small, but oh my. Yes, David was small, but oh my. He fought big Goliath, who lay down and died. Yes, David was small, but oh, 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 oh. Ever heard about Jonah? He lived in a well. You ever heard about Jonah? He lived in a well. And he made his home in that fish's abdomen. Yes, Jonah, he lived in a well. Seven, live clean and don't have no fault. Now take me, yeah, I take that gospel whenever it's possible, but with a little grain of salt.